So I this morning want to pick up on this very small part of that reading from Philippians. And it's that we are partners in the gospel. And for me here in South Wales, that's really, really important. I, as one of the regional ministers, have the remit of mission and enabling mission across the whole of South Wales, which I'm sure you'll understand is quite a mammoth task. And it's done in our partnership. And here, this is what the Apostle Paul is trying to impress on his first readers and us today, that we are partnering in the gospel. We partner in the gospel in many ways. But then he says, as we partner in the gospel together, we can be confident that he, God, Jesus, who began a good work in you, will carry it out into completion until the day of Christ Jesus. For me, this is fascinating because Paul's writing this letter while he is physically in chains. And every time he thinks of this church, this gathered community, he thinks of them, he prays for them with joy. And that is a challenge for you and I as believers in this day. Why? Because let's be honest, every time we think of people, do we really think of them with joy and thanksgiving? Or sometimes do we kind of roll our eyes and go, oh no, not them again. There's a reality here that Paul, in a dark circumstance, still gives joy. Why? Because of the partnership that they have together. And then he says that they should be filled with confidence. I don't know about you, but sometimes when I'm going through a difficult time, it's hard to be confident. When we're in difficulty, when we face challenges, it's hard to be confident. And yet here is the Apostle Paul in chains, declaring proudly that we are to be confident that the God who began a good work will carry it out into completion. And that's the promise that we hold on to as believers, that no matter how difficult things get, no matter how dark the circumstances, no matter how much we feel we are enchained, there is a confidence that we have, an inner strength in the ability of God that he will carry out what he has started to completion. We're reminded in the gospel reading from Matthew that you and I are responsible for bringing that work into completion because you and I aren't the sower. But we are responsible for creating a climate in which the seeds fall on good soil. So this word partnership is this Greek word, kalavakai. I don't know if I pronounced that rightly, but that's how I'm going to pronounce it today. And what that means is partnership, association, communion, fellowship, close relationship. And our role here in the South Wales Baptist Association is to make all our 140 churches feel like we are in a partnership, an association, a communion, a fellowship, a close relationship. Not just because those are good things, but because those are the things that help us, aid us, encourage us to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And that's what we all need to be about. This partnership that we've entered into isn't just a casual partnership. It's a partnership knitted together by the grace and power of God. One of the joys I have in my ministry is to go around and visit churches when I'm able to. And I hear and see some of the great things that they are doing. And the challenge I always bring to every church is, where is God in the midst of that? Anyone can put on a coffee morning. Anyone can do a food bank. What's different about us is we are in partnership, association, fellowship, communion, and close relationship, not just with one another, but with God. And therefore, what we provide as churches needs to create that good soil that needs to spread that seed in order to tell people the good news of Jesus Christ. So how do we partner together? And at one level, when I talk about partnership, I'm talking about how you as individuals within your church partner together, then how we partner as an association, and then how we partner in the wider world of the church community. And so we partner together in prayer. This is something the Apostle Paul got. This is something that the early church really understood. A few weeks ago, we celebrated Pentecost. What amazes me about Pentecost is there's a group of people in a room praying. And then the Holy Spirit turns up. And when the Holy Spirit turns up, it disrupts the status quo. Things change. All of a sudden, in a comma, they're then out on the streets preaching the gospel. It started in prayer. One of the things churches say to me so often, and I do a lot of mission consultancy as well, is, Hayley, how do we get the church to grow? And I say to them, pray. You want to see a growing church? Growing churches commit themselves to prayer, to fellowship. One of the things I did when I was a church leader was, and this is why you're probably thanking God that you have Leslie as your minister and not me, but I made the elders pray every week. And because I pastored a church just outside of London, everyone commuted. So the only time we could meet was 6 o'clock in the morning. And so every Monday morning at 6 o'clock, we would gather to pray. And I have to tell you, as a church leader, as irritating sometimes as it was to get up that early, there was something about committing to each other. There was something, as we prayed together, we shared our hearts. And so therefore we began to think of each other with joy every time we thought about each other, because we were journeying in prayer. And so my encouragement is for you to delve deeply in prayer as a church, but also know that we as an association are praying for you, and we would ask that you pray for us and the other churches. There are churches that are doing some really fantastic work. There are churches going through difficult times, and we are to cover and be in partnership in prayer with each other. The other way we partner together is in our presence. We pitch up, we show people. Paul couldn't physically do this, but we know that as soon as he was out of prison, he was in and amongst the gathered believers. And so we need to learn from that. And so as Christians within our local churches, we need to be all in. A commitment to Christ isn't casual. You can't sit on the fence. You have to go all in. And when we're all in as individuals in a church, we pitch up. We're present. We're there encouraging one another with our physical presence. And we do that, of course, within the association. We pitch up, we encourage one another in our presence. Why? Because it's good to do so. When we pitch up, our presence doesn't always have to be the same thing. And I'm sure you will have heard the Welsh government have very kindly said churches can open. They said this on Friday. They've still not released any guidelines to how that's going to happen. But if they follow the guidelines that England have, the likelihood is we can't shake hands, children can't run around, there's no singing. And it makes us think, what is a gathered community? What is being present in this day and age? What is being present as church? And it struck me that when the 3,000 people came to faith at Pentecost, they didn't then come back the next week and gather as 3,000 and sing songs for 45 minutes and listen to a 20-minute sermon. They were scattered in their communities. They were empowered by their experience, and their presence was to represent Christ in their everyday life. How do you represent Christ in your everyday life? How are you present in your scattered life. I want to ask you where your front line is. Your front line is where you spend most of your time. For some of you, that will be in the workplace. For some of you, it will be for family. Where are you bringing Christ's presence to your front line? We're to be prayerful and present as we partner in the gospel. And the third thing is providence. We all know this. This is an old biblical principle. It always amazes me when churches think about 10% of income, because that's quite an Old Testament theology. Again, Jesus says all in. They laid everything at the feet of the apostles. And so you and I are to use our resources in providence, in providing for each other. Now, when I say that, sometimes people get their backs up a little bit, going, oh, she's asking for money. I'm not. What I'm talking about is your resources. Your resources is your time, your finances, yes, but also the gifts that God has given you. What have you got in your hand that you are partnering in the gospel for? Are you using your gifts for the growth of the church, for the growth of the community, and for the growth of the church nationally and globally? What has God placed in your hands? It's really important that when God places a seed in our hands, we do everything we can to create the right culture for it to grow. There's enough people that want to stop the gospel happening without it being from within the church as well. And so we partner together in prayer, presence, and providence. So what does partnering together for the gospel, what might that mean for you and for us? Well, Leslie's going to go on and share in a little while about a new Wales-wide mission that we're launching across South Wales called Who Cares? And it might be that the way you partner in the gospel for this season is asking people in your workplace what hurts the most. And in doing so, you gather an answer in which you can respond with the gospel. It starts by listening. We do, as an aside, ask all our churches to give 5% of their income to home mission. Why? Because that helps support churches that need financial support at the moment. It helps to provide for us as an association team. And it also helps to provide for the specialist teams up in Didcot in Baptist Together. And I must admit, when I was a local church partner, I didn't pastor. I didn't think Didcot provided much. But the COVID-19 has shown me the depth of resources that they do. We also ask for our churches to partner with us in sharing their story, saying what's going on, and commit to praying for all our 140 churches. I wonder what partnering together for the gospel means locally for you as individuals in your church, for you as a church within the association, and for you as a church, part of God's holy people. Part of God's holy people, that he has brought about a good work. He will bring it to completion within all of you.